Hey everyone, and welcome to 1.21 Jigowatts. I am Peter, and that's Matt.
Family.
Family, indeed.
Family.
We talk about movies on this show, new movies specifically, and on this episode we are going to talk about The Fate and the Furious, aka Fast and Furious 8. Yes, 8 of these. We're on the 8th one of these. Here's just, before we even start talking about this movie, right? And obviously we'll start spoiler-free, give you spoiler warning before we give you spoilers halfway through. We always do that.
Here he goes. Pete in the nose.
All right. Before we even get to the movie, I just want to point out a couple of things that just astonish my mind when I think about them. This franchise is now 17 years old. Right? That's that.
Yep. Yep.
Something that I kept thinking about as I was watching this movie, whenever I got to the big action set pieces, you've seen them in the trailer, you know, on the ice, the one in New York City with all the cars, all these big action sequences, all big over the top, CG, all these big, you know, this movie cost like $200 million. All I could think during all these sequences was, in the first one, they were stealing DVD players from a truck. That was what they were doing. And there were criminals.
Point,
Paul Walker was trying to catch them.
Cars.
Yeah, well, that's what it was.
Point
it was
break with cars.
It was a Point Break ripoff. That's exactly what it was. But
and now they're doing James Bond stuff with Kurt Russell.
I
can't say that I'm upset about it because.
Well, I mean, I'm definitely not upset because I hated that first movie.
Yeah. See, I'm fond of that one. We're gonna have to do an influx of it.
Oh God, no! I don't want to watch it again, Matt. Kidding me? I didn't like the first one. I thought it was bland. I hated the second one. I never saw the third, never saw the fourth. I still haven't seen the fifth. I do intend on watching the fifth at some point because I know that's the
meta. You do, because that's where the fifth is really where it becomes its whole new franchise.
That's when it becomes it's what it is now, and it's when it becomes good. Yeah. AKA when they add The Rock, it got good. And
well, they became less about crime in like in undercover cops and more about. Hey, they're basically superheroes that.
Well, yeah. Again, talking about how much has changed since the first movie. The first movie, like, there was a legit concern that Paul Walker was worried that Vin Diesel might beat his face in with a wrench because he'd discover he was a cop. Whereas now he's a hero. He's a superhero. He's saving the planet.
Well, not in this one. If you know the trailers, he's the biggest threat.
Sure. You know? The plot is
which is a tried and true superhero threat. Where you have the one superhero that. Is forced to turn on the others.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, it's the Tower of Babel equivalent in the Fast and the Furious universe.
It is.
And I can't believe I'm talking about the Fast and the Furious universe, but that's the gist of it. So, basically this movie is the evil villain played by Charlize Theron, who's Cypher, who's this hacker person who's like better than everyone else and she's off the grid and all the rest of it. She has something on Dom which forces him to work for her. And as a result, he has to be the villain for a large part of the movie. I don't think that's spoiling anything to assume that maybe by the end of the film, he's not the villain anymore. But that's the gist of the plot. And you've got your all the like characters who are still around are back for this one. With the obvious exception of Paul Walker, but for obvious reasons.
I'm glad that he didn't have a cameo. Like, he got his send-off.
Well, you were worried we're going to CG...
Yeah, because it worked in the last one, so I was afraid that maybe they would try it, but I'm glad they didn't. Like, that's off the table. They refer to his character, but they don't, you know. Him and Mia are long gone in the sunset with their babies.
So that's fine. So, but all the other characters are back that they've sort of added to over the years. Like, the Ramsay from the last one's here, and obviously the other ones have been kind of brought in. Jason Statham's back for reasons, so I want to point out how ridiculous this movie is before we even get to all the main plot. Right? I'm not in spoilers yet. I shouldn't be talking about specific things. Okay, before we even talk about that, I'll just overall thoughts and feelings of the movie. It's silly. It's stupid.
It's big and dumb and it's fun. Like, it's everything that it should be, which is what I say, at least since Fast Five, because each one of them becomes a new genre. Like, Fast Five was a heist movie, and then Fast Six was like G.I. Joe, And then Fast 7, there's a revenge aspect, and here is the good guy gone rogue. So, you know, if you've ever get a chance to go to the Universal Studios tour in Hollywood, they have a segment of the tram tour that puts you in a Fast and Furious movie with screens and whatnot. And it's on point. Like, it's big and dumb and fun, just like the movies. So I'm glad that they don't try to make these dramatic powerhouses. They're just gonna keep going with the action.
Well, it was never that anyway.
I know, but you could see in the wrong hands, you could see them trying to do some dramatic.
No, I mean these movies BS. now they're about what is the most stupid over the top thing we can have them do with cars, and you know the last one had them parachuting out of a plane and cars and.
Yeah,
this one's got them on
the
ice.
Side of a mountain.
Yeah, this one's got them on ice.
With a submarine. Not a spoiler, that's in the trailer.
Yeah, like you've got all this stuff. And honestly, yeah. I thought this was mostly a pretty fun movie. It is really stupid. You have to... Everything you know about physics, you have to let that
physics
go.
Physics don't exist.
Let it go.
Physics don't exist in this world. And The Rock dropping his one-liners was a new level.
I will say about The Rock, I liked that he had more of a part in this one, because one of the things I didn't like about 7 is that it felt like he gets sidelined for like the majority of the movie.
Yeah, and that's because he wanted to be in it, but he also does a million other things.
Yeah.
So
whereas this one, he is more of a, and he kind of has to be, because if Dom's becoming the villain, they need
he needs to be the leader.
Yeah, we need a central leader to run the team, and he's the face to do that. Like I don't think any of the other ones would work based on who their characters are.
No. And it's always funny when you see them in the driving sequence, he's always in the biggest truck.
Oh, yeah, he's always got like, a big muscle car, whatever, regardless of what it is.
Well yeah, whereas Dom gets the nice, cool-looking classic car, and that's how you know it's him. The Rock's in the biggest truck possible that's somehow keeping up with all of these slam-down sports cars and whatnot. I mean, Tyrese is driving, a Ferrari or a Lamborghini on ice in this one.
And yeah,
I
think it's fun. I think Charlize Theron is good as the villain.
Yeah.
She's pretty sinister and that's cool. It's nice to see Kurt Russell back. Which, by the way, having Kurt Russell and Helen Mirren in it, like, again, go back to 2001 after watching that first one and say, oh, by the way, there's going to be a sequel to this with Kurt Russell and Helen Mirren in it. Like, come on. I wouldn't believe you for a second.
And I didn't realize Helen Mirren was in it until you had, you know, not that you gave me a report on it, but you're just like, yeah, and this person shows up, and this person, and they're good additions. So I will say about Charlize in this one is she's probably the best villain since 5, because everyone else, like, I thought Owen Shaw, who is, what's his name? He's just Gaston.
Luke Evans.
He was fine, but I didn't really feel his villain in 6. And in 7, it was Digimon Hansu. He was okay. Charlize really is a memorable, I think, in the series as a villain.
Yeah. So before we really do it, it's fun. It's dumb though. I think like honestly, that is basically the praise I can give it, and I wouldn't give it much more than that. Like it doesn't do anything particularly deep or smart or anything like that.
Yeah.
It is what it is, and it's enjoyable. But it's not a great movie by any means. Don't for the love of anything think it is before you watch it.
Yeah, it depends on what you think is great, because there's stuff in here that I equate funness with greatness. You know, that's why like my favorite movie of all time, Raiders of the Lost Ark. Like, yeah, it's a really good movie, but it's a lot of fun. And
yeah, but you don't compare Raiders of the Lost Ark to Fate of the Furies.
No, but that said, these are movies I enjoy. I don't watch them again. I enjoy them in the theater and then go from there. So.
Oh yeah, I've never. Since I started seeing these again with 6, I've not seen any of them more than once. Like, they've all just been the one time, never went back.
I will say there's certain scenes I will watch again, like in 5, which you do need to see, because there's an awesome chase where they're pulling a bank vault through the streets of Rio de Janeiro that is just fantastic in 5. So I've watched that one a couple times, but yeah, it's weird to say that in April this is a perfect summer movie. Like, I'd much rather see something like this than the next Transformers, because this doesn't, you know, assault my intelligence you know, I know what I'm getting into, if you will. Like, I'm signed up for this.
Well, you're not. You don't know what you're getting up for with Transformers at this point.
Oh no, because I got tricked on the last time. I got tricked with Dinobots, and I got some weird, stupid story with a Romeo and Juliet law. And like, no, you're not doing it to me again. You can bring all the King Arthur you want, Michael Bay. Laminated, not this time.
Laminated Romeo and Juliet card.
Mark Wahlberg as an inventor. Come on now. I'll take lack of physics to that any day.
Mm-hmm. Well, I don't really have anything else to say without spoilers. I want to talk about the absurdness of some of the scenes and stuff in the movie, so I won't get any spoilers. I feel like it's not a movie I can really talk about much without spoilers. As silly as that sounds, because you're thinking, is it that in-depth plot? Not really, but at the same time, I can't really talk about how silly it is without actually talking about the silly parts.
There are twists that are, you know, spoilers. Like, you have to talk about the story.
Yeah, so... But as well, I enjoyed it for what it was, but that's pretty much it. Like, I wouldn't give it any big praise.
I'm going to say, after doing these with Pete for the last, you know, we've gotten them, I think we've gotten two of them, or this is the third one since we've been recording.
Maybe?
Like,
I can't remember.
I think this is the most positive you've been on them.
Honestly, I think it's because I've almost just gotten used to them at this point.
that's what they do. That's what they do.
It's hard to be annoyed, or because at least it knows what it is. I think that's the praise I'll give it, is that it knows exactly how stupid it is and it just goes with it.
And that's fine.
Like, I like dumb horror movies, and they're dumb, but they know what they are. You know, dumb slashers from the 80s. They know how stupid they are, and that's fine, and they roll with it.
Before we get to spoilers, I listened to a podcast where the main producer, Neil Moritz, was on. And he had talked about when they'd done the first one, they were really shooting for a B-movie feel. Like, they didn't expect this to become an 8, you know, movie franchise plus. I feel like they hit that stride in B-movie.
Yeah.
You know, it's just fun. And
for the record, they've announced another 2. We have 9 and 10 already dated and planned. So, yeah, you can look forward to those. So it does know what it is. And that is honestly the biggest compliment I can give it, is that at least for as stupid as it is, for as unoriginal for the most part, it's like, I mean, the plots aren't that original. You could argue some of the set pieces you could argue might be original, and we'll get to
that. But it's not doing anything new. It's, you know, once you start involving nuclear codes, like,
you're just doing every you're doing every spy movie ever at this point.
Yeah, like, I've seen so many from the 80s that were the same thing. I mean, even The Man from U.N.C.L.E., which was set in the 60s, was doing the whole nuclear code thing. So,
all right, that's going to be spoilers then. So, full spoilers from this point on for The Fate and the Furious, or The Fate of the Furious.
Yep.
So. It gets ridiculous before we even get to the main plot stuff, because we get like a sort of prelude scene in Cuba, right? Where Dom and Letty are on their honeymoon, and for some reason, so Dom's cousin, who I don't believe I've ever seen before, am I right?
Never. Yep. Never.
Good, just so I'm on the same page. Right, so we've never seen this cousin before, and this cousin's got a dispute with No Way Jose from NXT, by the looks of it. If it wasn't him, it was someone like him. Some guy with a beard.
He's Cuban, not Dominican. So he's, you know, close.
Fair, but he's got the beard. And I just... not that No Way Jose has a beard, but it reminded me of him.
Me too.
But he's got this beard. He's like, oh, your cousin's not returning stuff, so I'm taking his car. And plot happened.
Well... Here's the thing, his cousin has this junker, and he's like, oh, it's my livelihood. I need this car. You can't take it. The guy's like, a deal's a deal. So Dom does the Shiny Knight, Aurasia for it.
Well, here's where it starts to get ridiculous. So people cheer. There's a crowd that forms around them who cheers, like they're in a high school fight, when he says, I'll race you for it. And he'll race you.
Because it's Dominic Toretto, Pete. He's world famous.
Shut up. He agrees to race in this shitty car, and he strips off some of the body to try and make it lighter, and he hooks up certain things in the tank to give him an extra boost that's dangerous, because Letty lets us know this is dangerous.
You're trying to get into a bomb.
Oh, dear. Right. So the bad guy like gets his like henchmen to throw bikes at him and stuff to slow him down along the way, and they're racing through Cuba. And
it's a Mario Kart scene. And like I've done this course in Mario Kart.
And, well, here's one thing that I had a problem with, but it occurred to me. Typically, these street races in the movies that I've seen before have been straight lines.
It's a drag race.
Yeah, we're in this. I'm seeing them like go round corners and go down, and I'm like, how does Dom know where he's going? They didn't really set a destination. It was weird. Whatever.
No, you're right. It's a Grand Prix, and he doesn't know the course.
Exactly.
So how are you going to... Yeah.
But eventually kicks in all these boosts, and the engine keeps getting red and red, and it eventually erupts in flames. The front of the car is on fire. So Dom...
Mind you, this is his cousin's car that he needs for his livelihood that's been established 3 minutes before.
So the front of the car is completely on fire. He flips it into reverse and drives backwards while the front of the car's on fire.
I imagine Mario throwing a fit at this because he's our resident car guy. He's my friend that I go to when I have car questions. Mm. And he got mad at Drive because of the inaccuracies. I can't imagine him watching this.
Yes, he's driving backwards, the front of the car's on fire. He just wins the race, and then the car's still going to blow up, so he has to let it drive off the beach into the water. Well, a crowd forms around him cheering, including children, and he picks up a child, and he's like almost posing for a photo.
He's Rocky.
Oh my God, the whole thing. And then he's like, I don't need to take your car. I've got your respect, and that's enough.
This guy's like, yeah, but what about my car? And of course Dom gives him his, but yeah, it was just a zany starting. I was worried. I was like, is cringy.
Do you want me to laugh though? Right, so Letty looks at him as he's holding up the kid, and we're like, okay, right, I see where the theme of this movie's going. It's going to be about them wanting a kid and so on. And then the next scene, she's asking him in bed, oh, we've never talked about having kids, why haven't we talked about it? Do you want me to laugh about this whole thing? So obviously, I mean, we're in spoilers, so it turns out the thing that Cypher has on him is that I assume this is a girlfriend he had in 5.
So Letty disappears in that sets up 6, right? She dies. Yeah. And
quote unquote.
So he moves on. And this girl was a liaison in Brazil for The Rock. But she ends up working with Toretto because it's a heist thing and whatnot. And so they kind of set them up as an item at the end of 5. But 6 all about recovering Letty. So you really don't see her again, ever.
Yeah,
until now.
I'm glad she was in 5, because when she showed up, I was like, wait, am I meant to know who this is? Because I really don't. But anyway, so she's got a kid. So she's got Dom's kid. And what made me laugh about this whole thing was that I don't know if you ever if you ever watched shows when you're younger, when they do like art projects and they show you how to start making it, but then they pull out one they made earlier.
Mm-hmm.
This made me think of it. Was like Letty's talking about, oh, we should talk about having kids. And then Dom's like, here's one I made earlier. It's here, there it is. As a kid.
We don't have the 9 months to wait, so here's this one.
And I'll tell you this as well. See, as soon as he's talking to the mother of the kid, and she's like, this is his middle name, but I thought the father should name him. I'm like, oh, I wonder what name he's gonna get at the end of the movie. I wonder.
Here's the logic with that though. Brian's still around. So when they give him the naming ceremony at the end, it's kinda like, well, that works if, like, Paul Walker has passed away.
Yeah, it works for us as an audience, but it doesn't really make that as much sense in the story.
Yeah, so now he has Uncle Brian to go to, and his name is also Brian. Like, had they named the kid Paul, I think that would have been a little more...
Yeah, but that meant nothing to the characters.
Yeah, but Brian means more. And Brian's still around. I don't get it.
Yeah, but to be fair, he's out of their life, and people do name their kids after people who are still alive as well. That does happen.
I know. I thought it was. I was hoping he was to name it after one of the cars. Like, that's really where I was hoping.
Oh no! It was so obvious they were going to name him Brian. It was so obvious that was, and it's the final moment of the movie. They leave it for the ending, and you get this big thing. Here's another weird thing I want to ask you about, right? Uh-huh. So Jason Statham, like, once Dom goes rogue, right, and Dom's with Cypher. Yeah. And nobody, Kurt Russell, happy to see
Kurt
him.
Russell.
And he assembles everyone. He gets The Rock out of prison because The Rock ended up in prison because of the job that Dom turned his back on him on. And
yeah.
Which, by the way, we'll talk about the prison escape in a minute. I'm not glossing over that. But
no.
So he assembles everyone, and he's like, right, and we're going to... Jason Statham, who was in the cell across from The Rock.
Who was the ultimate bad guy in the last one.
Yeah.
He had no redeeming qualities.
This is what I want to bring up, right? So I will accept that he secretly... He actually was all along wanting to get to Cypher because she's the one that ruined his brother's life. Gives him a common foe. I'll accept that he seemed dark in the last one, and he's now better in this one, and he's more of an anti-hero, and he becomes an ally. It's cool, because his scenes in this are really fun. He's got good banter with The Rock, he's fight scene when he's protecting the baby towards the end, really sort of slapstick and goofy and fun.
He becomes Lee Christmas from Expendables.
He does. Here's my one problem with this, right? So at the end of the movie, he's with all them. He's got the baby for Vin Diesel, and they're all on the roof, and he's part of the family now. And all
he was parachuting in, by the way, because the last time we see him, he's with the baby in the plane, and they're waiting on this rooftop. I thought he was gonna parachute down with the baby. Like,
I got those a time difference, so I didn't. But it's amazing all the same. But so he's with them. He's drinking the Coronas with them because it's always goddamn Corona. Because family. Corona. Because family.
And it's a barbecue. New York.
Right, so he's there. Now, correct me if I'm wrong, right? Correct me if I am wrong. But didn't Jason Statham's character kill one of their team members at the end of the third movie? Or they revealed later on it was him?
I think so.
Because that was the end of six. That was the cliffhanger for the next one. You've seen him get out of the car. He killed one of their teammates. One of their family.
He did kill Han. He ran the thing. That was the end of six, the post credits. Yeah. He's responsible for the death of Han. Yeah, so you're right.
And now they're all happy? I was like, yeah, let's hang out. Let's have a beer together.
Again, no redeeming qualities, yet somehow he's good guy.
I can almost get over the fact that he was trying to kill them all last movie, but he didn't succeed. Yeah. Right?
Right.
But he did actually kill one of them already.
Yeah, he did. And his brother's responsible for the death of another one in six.
Was that Gal Gadot or someone else?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, she falls out of a plane and becomes Wonder Woman. That's my head logic on that one. Lands on Themyscira after the 30-mile runway in that one.
Yeah. Oh god, that runway in six. Oh man. I'm not gonna let it ruin the movie or anything, but
No.
It's a little bit stupid.
It's a lot of bit stupid, Pete. I'm gonna go a step further.
I can
tell you the truth. I've forgotten about Han because I'm not a big fan of Tokyo Drift, and his death there always just felt like it wasn't necessary. They just did it to push dramatic stuff. So when he showed up in four and five, he was on borrowed time. You know,
this is the problem, is that they did this thing where they sit, because they ended up killing a character that everyone seemed to like from that movie, they ended up doing this thing where the next, like, three of them were all set before that movie.
Before Tokyo Drift,
so they could have him back, but they eventually just had to kill him. But the weird thing is that the killing him didn't really, it wasn't like there was a big story that led up to it. I mean, sure.
In a post credit.
Yeah, the retcon it by saying, oh, that was Statham because of the events of this and that was his brother, but whatever.
Yeah, I'm with you on that. But Statham in this, I thought was really... I love watching that dude on screen. Like, I'll watch a garbage movie he's in because he's fun to watch. But he's really good here. Him and The Rock have really good chemistry going back and forth.
Which actually, because that was the moment where I realized, wait a minute, why? Because it was when they started laughing with each other. As soon as they see each other, they have this running joke where they keep threatening each other over and over again, and they keep escalating the threats. And eventually, it's after they've been forced to work together where The Rock says he's going to shove something up his ass or something like that, and they both start laughing. And I was like, okay, good. And then a second later, I was like, wait a minute, didn't he kill one of the teammates already? Let's joke around with the guy who killed one of us. It was just...
Whatever. He's part of the family now. He's a crazy uncle.
Let's talk about the prison escape, though, because obviously it's this over-the-top scene of The Rock chasing Statham through the all the prisoners in the riot, right?
Yeah.
All fine. The one moment I want to point out that made me laugh because it looks so silly is that at one point The Rock does this slide under a banister.
Yeah.
But he starts to slide really early, so there's this shot of him slide. It just looks like he's sliding across the floor, and it looks really goofy. Yeah. It looked really cartoony. I just want to point that out.
And then he pushes off the wall, off like this netting, lands on the floor. Which I gotta say, it looked pretty cool, but The Rock's way too big to be doing that. Like, he should have gone through the net, because that dude's easily 280 pounds.
Oh, by the way.
Again, physics be damned.
See when it cuts to The Rock for his opening scene, and it's like a close-up of him giving this big speech about life and death and all that? I knew he was talking to kids. I could just see where the joke was.
Of course he was.
I could just see where the joke was.
And then he has
going.
Them do a haka like the New Zealand rugby team does. I got a good laugh out of that. Because the girls that, because he's coaching his daughter's soccer team, and the girls that are lined up, they're doing the haka too, which is meant for intimidation. One just goes, I don't want to play anymore. Like,
yeah, that was a funny line. But honestly, their reaction to the whole thing was just killing me, because they were just sort of standing like, what the hell's going on? Why are they all doing a tribal dance? What's happening? Yeah. Like, get us out of the field, mom, dad, take us home, it please.
They're taking this way too seriously. But no, I really enjoyed The Rock in this one, too. I feel like he had to, knowing that Vin Diesel was going to be the villain, he had to shoulder being the hero.
Yeah, and, he does. And actually, honestly, my biggest complaint with the actual plot, in terms of like Vin Diesel, you know, going rogue because he's been forced to, and obviously he's been forced to for a reason, and we learn what that is. So a big part of the movie is waiting for the fight, the moment when he can eventually turn around turn back and do the right thing. And that's a big moment when it happens. I think my biggest complaint, though, is that both at the start and the end of this story, it doesn't really feel like the characters are shocked enough when he turns bad. It feels really weird. The reactions don't play for me.
Yeah, no, because when kicks it off is they have to go get this EMP, right, that someone's stolen, and the guy tells The Rock, you know, if you get busted, you're disavowed, you're going to get burned, you go to jail for life. And they have it. They've recovered the MP, and then Dom flips because Cypher's already gotten to him. And when it happens, even his wife is kind of like, oh no, Dom, what have you done? And it feels like it lacks that. No, Dom would never do that.
It doesn't seem like they don't just react like it's a big shock. It's this weird confusion, and it doesn't really work for some reason. Although, I do want to point out during that scene when they're escaping with the MP, Ludacris has like a trap rigged. It's like a wrecking ball that comes down, which I just want to point out that is very similar to a video game called Split Second, where you trigger things like that to happen. And that's just what I thought of when it happened.
I like that it had an emoji on it with a winky face.
Yeah, I had the smiley face on it. Yeah. And then at the end of the plot, when he finally, like, it's a good moment when he finally, like, when he realizes, okay, my son's safe, you know, Jason Statham's got his son, he can finally say, screw you, and go and do what he needs to do. And the others are all in trouble because the submarine's gaining on them and stuff. So Dom shows up in the car to help them. My other problem is, as soon as he, like, shows up and helps them, all he does is, like, he blocks, like, one missile, or he stops one car that's shooting something at them. And they immediately go, oh, that's our Dom, he's back now. And they all just kind of accept that he's good again. No one even...
Yeah.
We never even get a scene where he tells Letty he has a son.
Yeah.
We don't see that.
She doesn't find out until... Yeah. Again, it goes back to 6 where they don't realize that they're married. And then he was just kind of like... There's a pause and I waited for him to go, I forgot. You know? Like, it's here. How come you didn't tell me you had a kid?
It was just because...
necessary. Like...
Because, so the submarine stops and they're all together and they're all hugging that, and then it cuts to the scene on the rooftop and she already knows about the kid. She already knows he's got a son. You kind of feel like her finding out that her husband has a son that she will now have to help raise is maybe something we should see. We should see that reaction.
Yeah, well, you kind of want that dramatic tension between the two. Just be like, well, I thought you were gone. You know, in Brazil, I was lonely, whatever. And then she's like, oh, well, he's part of the family now. You know, it doesn't have to be this big, huge moment, but you do want to see it.
It just glosses over in a really weird way, which I thought was really strange. All right, let's talk about the big set pieces. There's two big, like, action-y sort of sections in the movie. One's in New York, one's in, I can't even remember where they go, somewhere where ice, was it? I think it was...
They're in Russia.
Russia, yeah. It was a Russian submarine base.
Yeah, and it's been, like... left alone, and it's desolate, except there's soldiers everywhere.
Yeah.
It doesn't add up.
So the first action sequence in New York, where Cypher starts to, like, you know, remote control all the cars that have auto drive systems in them. And that's when you see it in the trailer as well, all the cars coming out the windows in the car park and crash landing around the Russian like minister or president or whoever it is that's in town. And that's a I like both the action sequences for different reasons. I like this one because they know Dom's probably the most dangerous one in a car. So when they're trying to catch him, they do this thing where all five of them like fire hooks and they try and hold them.
I
thought that was quite inventive. I thought that was a fun little thing because it felt like they all had to work together to match how good he is in a car.
And that was it. That was because Letty does it first, and then you know another guy pops on, and then they all get into position and they have him. Except Dom's always you know one step ahead of them because that's his team. Well, you know,
I wouldn't say he's one step ahead. He just luckily has such a powerful goddamn engine that he is able to eventually break free.
Yeah. Which I thought, like, I'm not a car guy, but once they start naming off the horsepower, you're talking about the horsepower of a tank in a muscle car. Like, correct me if I'm wrong, people that are car people, but I think they get up to 5,000 horsepower. Just doesn't. I think he would have gone through the gas before getting out of there. That's all.
It was pretty inventive, though. Obviously, it's not as silly and ridiculous as the submarine at the end when it's firing torpedoes. No. And the Rock the Rock gets out of his car and re-aims their torpedo to hit one of their cars.
I loved it, though. I loved it. I love that he says, "Hold on," and him and Tyrese have some good chemistry too, because Tyrese is just this brash, cocky guy, and The Rock is constantly having to put him in his place.
Well,
they
have some pretty fun. All the team have some pretty fun running jokes throughout the movie. There's a whole thing where after the job, they pulled it all in the top 10 most wanted list from the FBI, except Tyrese, who didn't quite make it. He was number 11.
He's 11.
And so there's a constant running joke about him referencing that. There's him and Ludacris are still trying to fight over the new girl, Ramsey. They're trying to impress her.
When he helps The Rock redirect the torpedo, there's just some good back and forth there between them. Because Roman's so... I feel like he's only on the team because he's Brian's friend. And he's a semi-good driver. Like, he shouldn't be there, you know? And they get a lot of comedy out of that. But just...
It was pretty funny because he's obviously really... He's like, I'm determined to take out this fancy sports car. Even though they're all driving on ice. And he immediately starts spinning out of control. He's like, of course you're spinning out of control. It's not built for ice, you tit.
And they all start targeting him. And Ludacris is like, that's because you're in an orange Ferrari.
Which is a callback.
Out on ice.
Which is a callback to an earlier line about him sticking out too much because it's a ridiculous looking car. But he ends up like skiing on his car door. At one point, on one of the grappling hooks, and the action scene at the end is pretty fun. It's got a lot of ridiculous stuff.
The guy that directed this too, F. Gary Gray, he's more of a big action guy. So I was surprised to see he's not like Justin Lin.
It depends what you look at, because technically he's done more action than he's not.
Has he? I looked up his filmography, he Law Abiding Citizen, but that was kind of a...
He did the Italian Job remake, he did The Negotiator.
Oh, he did, okay.
It's funny,
I forgot he did Italian Job.
When I saw he did I've never seen the Italian Job, actually, but when... neither version. But when I saw he did Straight Outta Compton, I thought, he must be like I assumed he was, like, newish, and that was, like, his, like, you know, coming out to Hollywood, first movie kind of thing. But no, he's been directing movies since the 90s. He's been around a while.
Oh, he did A Man Apart. Too with Vin Diesel, that was an action-y one.
No, I meant
to I just when I skimmed it before we were recording, so that's why. I mean, he done Friday and Straight Outta Compton and Be Cool, so those are the ones that stuck out to me.
Now, admittedly, none of those action movies have got the same over-the-top, ridiculous action that this one does, but
yeah,
there you go. So obviously the big action, the big thing that ends it is obviously Vin Diesel like makes the heat-seeking missile track him, and he like drives up over the submarine so that it hits the submarine. And then there's a great moment at the end where to protect him from the flames, all the family in the cars surround him and shield him with the cars at the last minute, which is a really good moment. Admittedly, had we got a moment of them going like. It's almost weird. It's like they accept that he's turned like not really properly, but then they accept that he's back really easily. I don't know. Other than that decision being weird, that's actually quite a nice moment when they all team up to protect him. It's a really yeah. sort of heartwarming kind of thing. Mm-hmm. So,
and we joke that it's always about family, right?
Like it is. Like even Charlize Theron in this movie, she questions uh-huh. like, "Oh, you're not about family. You say you're about family, but you're not. You're about other things." And then they debate the importance of family with each other. It's like a running plot thread throughout the entire damn movie. If anything, this one's more about family than any other ones I've been. So family times family to the power of infinity.
Family squared. Yeah. But yeah, but I felt like this really drove that home and that it really showed it in this one and then in some of the other ones. So
where it's all talk.
Yeah. And so here when they do come together to you know, protect him and he is doing this for family and whatnot.
Yeah.
But yeah.
If I'm going to have any other sort of criticisms, I do think there is occasionally some questionable CG in this one.
Okay.
I think the last one, they made a lot more of an effort to use a lot more real cars. Whereas yeah. in this one, there was definitely some CG cars at times, and there was definitely some like speed-up effects going on. Which made it feel a little bit less authentic. Because the big action scenes were a lot of fun because they were over the top and they were silly, but there were some moments in them that felt very obviously, oh, this is someone running in front of a green screen or jumping from a green screen or kind of thing. Like, there was a little bit more of that obvious stuff going on. At least I thought it was, anyway.
Mm-hmm. The fight scene in the prison was a little much with the shaky cameras. I'm over the shaky camera for a fight scene. You know? Especially when you have The Rock and Jason Statham, who are both really accomplished actors. Like, you lock the camera down.
By the way, actually, at one point in that fight, when he's going through the prisons, The Rock essentially rock bottoms someone onto a bar.
It's always... He works that into just about every movie, I feel like.
Yeah.
You know, where he has to fight someone.
I mean, it's not quite, because he's not going down to the floor, but it was the same, you know, arm over the shoulder.
Yeah.
The same thing.
And let's just say, it's not very... good to do in an actual fight, right? Like,
well, duh.
You're putting the dude, you leave yourself vulnerable. So, but he's, and that dude, he looks bigger every time I see him in these movies. Like, pretty soon he's gonna be Hulk sized, like, and taking up, you know, an eighth of the screen.
Yeah, we haven't even talked about Little Nobody.
Yeah, which. I feel like he was only there to take the place of Paul Walker.
Pretty much. It felt like they needed another person, and he's kind of just bland and forgettable and basically annoying. Because he's supposed to have this arc where he's like a stick in the mud, and he doesn't want them to let them use anything. He wants to play exactly by the rules and never do anything off book.
Yeah.
And then there's obviously a moment at the, you know, going into Act 3 where he finally says, screw it, let's break the rules. And he says, let's take all the cars we want. But to be honest, it doesn't really work. He's kind of still bland and forgettable, and... I don't know. I don't think Eastwood's a bad actor necessarily. He just
no.
I just think the character has nothing going for him. It's weird.
Yeah.
So
he's just there. I mean, I do like the stuff that he did with Mr. Nobody with Kurt Russell, but I feel like Kurt Russell's so turned up in it, you know, that he has to be the subdued one.
Yeah, I mean, those scenes are fun because of Kurt Russell, but I don't think he really... I mean, you could have put anyone in that other role, and it would have worked the same way.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
Yeah, I think those... He's just kind of forgettable and bland, whereas the other characters all have their thing. They all have their thing that makes them memorable, and they do their... So, that's kind of a thing. There's also a big ginger-bearded man who is the henchman of Cypher.
Yeah, he's on Game of Thrones. He's Tormund Giantsbane. Yeah, he's a Nordic actor. He has a real difficult name to pronounce. I'm gonna
Hive look forward here. Hivju or Hivju.
Yeah. Where do you go? Christopher Hivju.
Well, Christopher's easy, but
I was going off of his last name. I was just gonna use the last name. But yeah, he's Norwegian. So and he's good. He's a big, like, menacing henchman, you know, doesn't have much else to do, which he's great on Game of Thrones. I know you're not a huge Thrones fan, but he's really good there. Much better than he is here, I can say. And he kind of plays the same role, except opposite alignment. He's more of a good guy on Thrones. But I didn't realize how big he was. Like, you see him standing next to Vin Diesel, and he's a pretty big fellow.
Obviously, we mentioned Helen Mirren's in the movie. She's got the Cockney sort of accent on, and she's, like, slapping Jason Statham in the face, saying, "Be good to your brother, you little shit."
But yeah. I like that. I liked her playing like this, because usually when I see Mirren, she's playing, like, a upper-crust society lady, you know? So to see her kind of play more of a lower, you know, because sons are criminals, basically. You know, they were special forces, but they flipped. So I kind of like that. Although the whole plot to get her involved, I thought was a little out there, even for this movie.
Yeah, it was a bit contrived, but I think at this point you kind of go along with that. The problems that stick out, and the reason why I talk about the reactions of, like, Dom turning and then turning back, those stick out to me more because I can forgive, like, weird, like, leaps in logic or, like, you know, playing with the rules of, like, physics or even legal rules or whatever. Like, all that sort of stuff, fine. But even in a movie like this, I feel like the characters' reactions to other things and the relationships with each other are the things that should still feel right. Which is why them not reacting properly or not getting a scene where they get to react to something important feels weird. Those are the things that even in a movie like this feel like they should still line up, and that's maybe why those two parts of it feel a lot off. But it's fun. It's relatively well-paced. It's got some really ridiculous over-the-top action scenes. We mentioned Jason Statham with the baby, sort of, like, you know, ducking the baby to the side, and, like, he talks to the baby and says things in mid-fight, and then he's basically doing, like, a Jackie Chan bit. Like, this makes me think of Jackie Chan.
It is. Yeah, and I really enjoyed that. I like that he puts the headphones on so, you know, the baby doesn't have to deal with the gunshots and whatnot. And, yeah, and he just keeps looking down, and the baby's cute, which is always good. But yeah, God, I really like Jason Statham in this movie. And he went from being such the villain that you want to see get taken down to, I wanted to see more of him here. So, you know, when that plot hits that he, quote, dies, you're like, he's not gone. He can't be gone.
Oh, no, it was obvious, you know, he wasn't gone. Diesel had just made a deal with his mother. It was obvious it was a fake death for later on.
Oh, well, of course. But, like, it was just like, I want more of him on the screen. And now you're depriving me of more of him on the screen. So,
he'll
want another Expendables,
He'll be back next time. Well, one thing I think is important to mention as well, though, is they don't actually get Cypher. Charlize Theron is open to come back to the next one because she escapes. Yeah. She gets out in a parachute and we don't see her again, which means that at least somewhere along the way, they knew, oh, wait a minute, she's probably the best villain we've had. Let's not kill her so we can have her again.
Yeah.
Let's have her come back pissed off that she got beat. And she can come back full throttle, pardon the pun.
Yeah. Remember in the first one that the main bad guy was Johnny Tran, the super entitled Asian guy? He was the big villain. Now we have a cyber terrorist that what?
I don't remember. I don't remember a villain in the first one. Wasn't Vin Diesel technically the villain in the first one?
Yeah, but Johnny Tran was the one that, you know, they have the friend killed because he loses the race, and he takes off in the car, and he sends the guys on the motorcycles. That's who we're dealing with. In 8 now, we have a legit cyber terrorist that parachutes out to return. Like, again, just driving home Pete's that they were stealing DVD players and dealing with local thugs, and now we got full-on Bond villains, if you will, you know?
We have action set pieces. We didn't have that in those early movies. Mm-hmm. We have these big, larger than life, ridiculous things. That first movie did not cost $200 million to make.
No. We need to, if you're interested in Influx to make Peter watch The Fast and the Furious again, you leave a comment.
Nope. If you want me to hate the shit out of it, if you happen to like that movie, I'm going to tear it to shreds because I think it's boring as shit. So that's not happening. Not happening.
Oh, man. I like to try to make Peter watch movies he hates.
No. But I think that's pretty much us then.
Yeah.
That's Fate and the Furious. It's a pretty fun time. It's stupid. There's a lot of things you can poke holes in, but the characters are usually entertaining and funny. Which is why, oddly, Vin Diesel's kind of the weak link almost, because he's the one that's not that funny or amusing.
Yeah,
most of the time
he's kind of the straight man.
He plays it straight, which is kind of important. But he's very much the one who's meant to be brilliant at what he does, but everyone else is the entertaining parts. There you go, Matt. Ratings. What would you give Fate of the Furious?
Oh man,
out of the tens.
Oh. I want to just to see your face, I want to give it high, but I won't. It's probably a 6, I think. I'm going to give it that's about as high as I'll go.
That may surprise you, Matt, but I'm going to agree with that number. 6 out of 10 is, I think, fair for this, because it's fun, yeah. It's not great, it's not I don't think it's a great example of anything, but it is decent, dumb fun. It's probably the best Michael Bay movie since the 90s. If that makes any sense.
Yeah.
What I mean by that is Michael Bay movies now are like in their own territory of just being shit, whereas this is at least still entertaining for what it is. And like I say, much like the slasher movies that I enjoy from the 80s, much like stuff like that, it knows what it is, and because it knows what it is, it can just have fun with it, and you can accept the goofiness, and you can accept the physics breaking nonsense, and just have a decent time.
Yeah. I'll agree with that. You know what you're getting in for. Like, this was the first one when I saw the trailer that I wasn't like, I'm not that stoked. But when I was into the theater, I was just like, of course I was seeing this. This is what these are. And for a middle of April movie, it's a good spot for it, I think.
Also,
not going to get lost.
I'll mention that we weren't planning on doing this.
Yeah.
And then Matt just messaged me like the day before it came saying, hey, Pete, do you want to go see Fate and the Furious?
Yeah. Well, I thought Connor was going to see it, because I know that you're not a big fan of these movies. So you surprised me by actually like, yeah, sure, I'll go to the movies.
Well, these last few have been decent fun. My disdain for the name Fast and the Furious comes from the first one, which I think is bland as shit. Connor feels pretty much the same way about the first one, and he's not seen any of the ones.
Like, he's only seen 1 and 2, I think he said. He hasn't gone past there.
He hasn't seen any of the recent ones. Because he was saying that when he went to see something else a couple of weeks ago, and he saw the trailer for this, and he's like, what the hell's happened to this franchise? The last time he's seen it was DVD players in a truck. And he's watching the trailer, and it's like a torpedo on ice, and like kicking it with the rock. And oh, dear. All right, so there you go. That's The Fate of the Furious. I can't believe we went hitting 50 minutes on that, but there you go. So let us know what you thought of Fate and the Furious, whether you're a casual fan or you've seen them all, you've not seen all of them, whatever. Let us know. We're always curious. Like and subscribe, all that stuff. Helps us out a lot. Get us on Twitter at mailed_fuzz for channel updates. Yep. I'm at Wibble89. Matt is at MattOfSteel57.
Yep.
And, yeah, obviously, other movie stuff going up. Me and Connor just did a 1.21 influx on Guardians of the Galaxy, because the new one's coming soon. That just went up earlier today, in fact, so that's still easy to find. You can check that out, see what not what we thought, because we already knew we liked it, but you know what I mean?
Yeah.
We look back on it and see.
Does it hold up 3 years later? Has it been 3 years?
Yeah, 3 years, and it does. Yeah. It holds up pretty well.
Oh, of course it does. I thought that was tongue-in-cheek, Pete, because it clearly is.
To be fair, I think there's a lot of Phase 1 Marvel movies that do not hold up that well.
No, but Guardians is that it's its own thing. Like, it has more in common with itself. That makes no sense, but, you know, it really is its own thing. It's not superheroes. It's space misfits, and it works.
I could respond to that, but I spent like an hour talking about it. I already did that.
Go check it out, guys.
Go check out Influx. You can see what my response is to that. But now, thanks for watching, guys. Keep watching movies, and we'll be back, hopefully, not too distant future, with another new movie. It's a little bit quieter for the next couple of weeks until Guardians comes out, I think, because we had a really busy March. March was really busy for new movies into April, but hopefully we will see you soon. So thanks for watching, guys, and we will see you next time.
Family.